Welcome to Froom FM Soundcheck on 96.6 FM, online at froom.fm and on Facebook Live. You've just been listening to Ange Hardy, who was on Froom FM Soundcheck last night. But tonight, in the studio, on the set in the studio with us, we have Jon Pickard. Hello, Jon.
Hi, Patrick. Thanks for having me on.
Hi, thanks for coming, Jon. All the way from Bruton, I think.
Yes, that's right. Yeah.
That's great. And you've got a rather curious instrument.
Yeah, one that isn't that well suited for radio, I suppose. It's called a harp guitar. Anyone can see it on Facebook. You can see it's a bit of a weird looking thing, but for people on radio, it's like a guitar, but it's actually got 23 strings.
Okay, we'll go into that a little bit later. But first of all, this is a live music show, so we're going to ask you to play, give us some live music. And you've given us a short set list, which I'll allow you to introduce. Okay.
Well, the first piece I'm going to play is called Beating Heart. And it's kind of about the way the heart communicates. I won't go into the details about it too much, but it's the first piece of harp guitar music that I wrote. I hope you like it anyway. It goes a bit like this.
It's great. Thank you. Thank you.
Beating Heart. Yeah. Beating Heart.
Yep.
A little bit about that and your next track, which I see is called Scallywag's Breakfast.
Scallywag's Breakfast, yeah. This is, I suppose this is dedicated to my youngest daughter, who ran about the breakfast table, insisted on, when she was about four, used to insist on, you know, tapping out rhythms on the breakfast bowl with her spoon, getting told off for it, and some of the dramas and fun you can have around the breakfast table with a four-year-old child.
Right, excellent.
And I suppose it's the way a child's mind can flit from one extreme to another extreme in that kind of random, and the amount of different moods and experiences they can have over, you know, 10, 15 minutes over the breakfast table.
And how old is this daughter now?
She's five now.
Okay, so she's not old enough to be embarrassed by this yet?
Not yet, no, but yeah. I'll look forward to embarrassing her when she's older.
Excellent. Okay, yeah. Scallywag's Breakfast.
Yeah, I need to retune the guitar a little bit. So these instruments kind of complicated. Thank you.
Scallywag for breakfast. It's interesting. We'll come in more on later, but just sit. Very privileged seat here, sitting right next to you, watching you play this. I think you pay good money for that at many venues.
I hope so.
Yeah, okay. We'll talk more about the instrument later, but that's really quite an exquisite sound because of the, presumably, the 23 strings.
Yeah.
Scallywag breakfast is about your daughter. Mm. Therefore, can we guess what Wayfarer on the Path to Holy Cross Abbey is?
Well, the next two tunes aren't written by myself.
Right.
They're written by, I wanted to sort of show some of the history, recent history, I suppose, of harp guitar music. There's lots of great harp guitarists and composers out there. The next two tunes are written by a guy called Jon Doan, a friend of mine in America, who's probably one of the best in the world of harp guitar players, especially with the instrument with the super treble version. And he traveled around Ireland seeking inspiration for lots of sort of Celtic style music. So I've learned two of his tunes. This instrument is kind of loosely modelled on his instrument, and he kind of redefined the instrument 20 years ago and wrote some wonderful music for it. So I'm going to play two tunes by him.
Okay, that's great. I'll leave you to it.
Okay. Again, I need to tune up first. Thank you.
Splendid.
Thank you. Beautiful music. You write just wonderful music. I'm not on mic. I need both hands to tune up, I'm afraid. You'll have to
okay,
hold the mic.
Don't worry, I'll hold the mic. You're tuning it between each piece. Is that because it needs obviously it's because it needs retuning. Is each piece in a different key?
Exactly, that's the thing, yeah.
Yeah. I'll very briefly describe the instrument while you're doing that. Mm. It's 23 strings, six of which are conventional guitar strings with a fretboard.
Mm-hmm, that's right.
And the other 17, if I've got my maths right.
Something like that.
Are we given pitch for the duration of the piece you're playing?
Yeah, if you're playing a harp, you need to have the harp strings tuned to play the scale that you want to make the piece sound right.
That's what you're doing between the pieces.
That's right. So each of the harp strings only has one note available to it. There's no frets, you can't change the notes. So
okay.
If I need a G sharp instead of a G natural, I've got to tune up before the piece starts.
Right, okay.
And that's what I just did.
Okay, that's great. Right, thank you.
With any luck, I'll remember to get the right tuning for the right piece. Okay. That's always a bonus.
Great. Thank you.
So what am I playing next? Okay, got this one right. Okay. So the next tune is called Resting on Jacob's Pillow. And when John Donne plays this tune, he tells the story of how the piece was written. It goes back to the Old Testament story of Jacob resting his head on the pillow and getting the vision of the stairway to heaven, the angels coming up and down on the ladder. Mm. Many myths and legends associated with that stone, that particular stone that he laid his head on. And apparently, according to some myths and legends, that stone got carried all the way over the period of thousands of years and ended up in Ireland, according to the Irish legends. And John was exploring Ireland, and he came to hear about this stone lying out in the hill somewhere. And he sought out this stone, and he found it in the middle of the night with his torch. And he went out specifically to find it, to gain inspiration to write a piece of music. And he says that as he went out and found it, there it was on the ground there. He lay down, rested his head on the stone, and heard this music.
Okay, that's great.
So this is Resting on Jacob's Pillow.
Thank you.
Resting on Jacob's pillow.
Yeah.
Okay, we've only got a few minutes before we move into the second part of the show, so I want to talk a little more about your music and this instrument, which I will now... The harp guitar.
Yeah.
That's the correct term for it.
That's right, yeah.
Okay. I'm just going to describe it a little more for the benefit of those who are on the radio rather than on Facebook Live. 23 strings. When I describe this, I'm starting from the top of the instrument, by which I mean vertically, the bit that's nearest to your chin.
Yeah.
It's got a body rather like a conventional guitar, but with an extra bit leading towards the end with the tuning pegs. Mm. You've got 7 strings, which are harp strings. They have no fretboard.
Yeah, these are the sub-bass strings, the extra low
sub-bass strings. That answers one of the questions I was going to ask, is that because you've got 10 strings the other side of the fretboard, are they also in order of tuning as you go down the the harp guitar?
Yeah. Shall I show you those as we go then? Yeah. So, I mean, most guitarists will be familiar with the 6 strings and the lowest string. The lowest string on the guitar section is normally an E in normal tuning, isn't it?
Yeah.
So, the first string below that in pitch is the sub basses.
Yeah.
It was a D. So it goes D, C, B, A, G, F down to low E. So you've got an extra octave, if that means anything to musicians anyway.
Yeah. And then the other side, the 10. The 10 that are vertically below the fretboard.
Yeah. Again, they go up from E. So you take the E on the 12th fret on the guitar, on the first string, the octave E, is the same as the first treble string.
Yeah.
So that's where you're starting from. And it goes up like the white notes on the piano, if you like.
Yeah.
In whatever scale you've got.
Okay. And there's a long history to the harp guitar?
Yeah, they're actually, instruments like this anyway, harp guitars, they're kind of loosely defined as an instrument a bit like a guitar with the fretted strings plus any number of extra floating harp strings.
Okay.
And they were actually around before the guitar in its history settled onto a 6-string format, really. So
these are almost the pre... I mean, the first thing I saw when I saw it was the modern, almost gimmicky guitars with two necks.
Yeah.
But actually, they're even older than the conventional model of the guitar itself.
Really, yeah. I mean, they were. You know how guitars evolved from lutes, you could
yes.
say? Well, there are still today, if you like, harp lutes. Have you heard of a theorbo?
Yes.
Like a medieval instrument, a lute with extra bass strings. Very, very similar. And there were versions with extra treble strings as well 500 years ago.
So, in fact, it's rather than the question of why a harp guitar, it's actually it's an evolution that led to the conventional.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, I think it got condensed down to 6 strings because it's simpler to play as 6 strings and it's cheaper and easier to build.
Well, it's one of the things, because I've been watching you play it. Like I say, I've got the best seat in the house by a long way here, sitting right next to you, watching you play it, because on occasion you're actually, it's entirely finger picking for obvious reasons, and on occasion using both hands to finger pick.
Yeah. There's moments where you want to be up here on the high strings, and you just can't reach to the low strings, so you can actually kind of reach down over here.
Which, of course, with a conventional harp, you'd use both hands anyway. But
Exactly. Okay. Or a pianist uses both hands quite happily, don't they? So.
Yeah, okay. And just one quick question. You've got on the top, you've got these minor keys here, which are just inside to the below the tuning peg.
Sharpening levers. These are actually from harps. These are used on harps.
Right.
I've borrowed them from the harps, you know.
Right.
And they basically, like I say, if you need a G, this string is a G. And if you want a G sharp, you flick the lever.
Right, so you've got a G sharp. A little tension.
Yeah.
So you can lift it
up a semitone of a half step.
Yeah. Okay.
Depending on the key you're playing in.
Okay, that's great. And how did you come to play one of these?
Well, I saw a video of a guy called Jason Carter playing the harp guitar. He's a modern guy, English guy, who plays harp guitar. And this was probably about 6 years ago or so. I came across it on YouTube in this technological age that we live in. There's all these videos around. And it blew my mind, basically. You know, it's like, I just stood there, my jaw dropped to the floor. And it's like, the musical possibilities of one of these instruments is just staggering. So it's like, I just knew straight away. I've got to have one of those.
Yeah. Excellent. Good stuff.
Took me 5 years, but I got there in the end.
Okay. We're going to move into the middle third of the show, where we talk about the music you've selected. We asked you to come up with a playlist of 5 tracks, and what you selected and why.
Sure.
So we're going to kick off with, given the music we've been hearing, this might come as a little bit of a surprise to our audience.
Which one we have first?
Queen.
A Queen song, yeah, okay, yeah.
Dead on Time.
Yeah, well, I was very much into Queen as a teenager. It was very influential.
Me too. Yeah,
good.
Yeah.
Brian May as a guitarist was very, very, very influential to me. I used to get ribbed an awful lot by my school friends saying, "You sound just like Brian May," or trying to sound just like Brian May, you know. In those days when I played electric guitar as a teenager, so I used to listen to a lot of that thing and lots of other things as well, but it was very influential. I chose this track because it's not very well known. It wasn't a single, it's just an album track, but it's probably one of my, just about my favourite tracks for the sheer energy of the whole band, really, but the guitar parts and Freddie, of course. And
okay.
So a lot of people may not have heard this unless you happen to listen to Queen albums.
Okay, that's great.
Hope you enjoy it.
Dead on time, Queen. That was Dead on Time by Queen, chosen by Jon Pickard as one of your influences.
Absolutely.
1978?
Yep, that's right.
Mm. Okay. Mm. Right, well, I was 12.
All right.
So, but I did. Yeah, I remember from that.
Seven.
Yeah, I do remember them from that era. Mm. The next one is also very much from something I remember as a teenager, Ghost Town The Specials.
Yeah, I guess it was just one of those. I was never into The Specials that much, but I enjoyed the two-tone movement a bit. I remember dancing at discos to those kind of things. And I've just chosen a couple of tracks when I was a kid that I used to enjoy. That also now my own kids enjoy because I stick on the
Absolutely. iPod. Well, you do, don't you?
Yeah, exactly.
And also, I mean, it's amazing how influential those years are.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. And this track in particular, I didn't hear it for like decades. And then I just thought, oh, I wonder if I can find that somewhere. So I found it and downloaded it and just started loving it again. You know, and this particular track has got such a mood, such an atmosphere to it.
Yeah.
Unforgettable, really.
Okay. Ghost Town, The Specials. That was The Specials, Ghost Town, chosen by our special guest, Jon Pickard, on Soundcheck, Froome FM, 96.6 FM and online, and on Facebook Live. That definitely resonates from its era, doesn't it?
Yeah, what a great track. It's really, you know, I wasn't that much into that kind of two-tone movement at the time, but I remember going to the discos and stuff and dancing to all the kind of stuff that was around there. But it's one of those things you listen to decades later, and it really just takes you straight back there, doesn't it?
There's a very definite vibe to it, isn't there?
Yeah, yeah. It wasn't not typical of that band much, I suppose.
Not at all. You know, but there's quite that ghostly atmosphere.
Yeah.
They did it pretty deliberately, brought into the track.
It was really reflecting the political climate of the times, wasn't it?
It was, yeah.
People, things getting closed down. And
yeah. Yeah, it does conjure up images of northern towns. I'm from the north, so I can say that, where the industry had gone.
Yeah.
It does conjure that up.
Yeah.
Moving on. You've now chosen a track which, politically, the title became well-known, because it's Perestroika, which is a phrase used by Gorbachev, but I don't suppose that was why you chose it.
No, I don't really know the story behind how the track was written. It's written by written and played by Stephen Bennett, perhaps one of them, if you're into harp guitars, he'd be probably one of the most famous harp guitarists that there is, and one of the best, certainly. Wonderful, wonderful guy. He's been around for decades, and he plays not just harp guitar, but six-string as well. Plays all over the world. And this is from one of his kind of greatest hits, or sort of compilation albums, if you like. He's done many, many, many albums, and I've only got the one album of his. I need to get some more. This is the first track on the album. It's just a wonderful, stonking track.
Okay. Perestroika, Stephen Bennett. Perestroika by Stephen Bennett.
Stephen Bennett, yeah. Thank you for that track, Stephen. Wonderful.
Yeah, it was beautiful, yes. We have just Googled it while we were listening, and Perestroika, we recall the movement, it was restructuring. And we guess the song must have been very much of that era.
Yeah, that's right. The rising up of the unions, wasn't it, leading ultimately to the fall of the Berlin Wall. So yeah. I don't know what relevance the word has to the creation of that particular piece of music, but still.
For linguists, Perestroika means restructuring. It's Russian for restructuring, and a beautiful piece of music there. We're moving on through your selected playlist
to next?
A John Doan song. Is that how you pronounce
it?
John
Doan, yeah.
John Doan. Yeah. And it seems to be something about Yeats.
Yeah, I think it's just, I mean, William Yeats was a poet, wasn't he? And he inspired John to write a couple of pieces of music, I think. I don't know too much behind the background of this particular story. It's just a lovely, lovely tune. I wanted to play some harp guitar music, some proper, authentic, really good harp guitar music rather than the new stuff which I'm doing, in the hope that people might just like it. I don't know. Just people probably haven't heard of harp guitar music. Most people haven't heard of it, except for all my Facebook friends. So I wanted to just kind of play a couple of really nice tunes from a couple of masters. So that last track and this one by Jon Doane.
And therefore, obviously, I mean, you've been playing two tracks by Jon Doane in the first half of your set.
Yeah, so he's a pretty big influence on my harp guitar.
He's
playing.
A big influence on your playing. Yeah. Okay. So this is Yeats Country, Where William Lies.
That's right. He visited William Yeats's grave. But you'll have to look him up on YouTube, and I'm sure you'll find him telling the story of how this track was created.
Okay, but we're listening to Jon Doane and Yeats Country. And that was Yeats Country, Where William Lies by Jon Doane. Not only another harp guitarist, but a very eminent harp guitarist, from what you tell us.
Yeah, if there's any such thing. I mean, harp guitar isn't very well known, but amongst them all, he's, for me, the best, I think. Right, his music speaks to me more than the others do anyway. There's plenty of other great players as well, don't get me wrong.
We've already explored the early history of the harp guitar, but in conversation with you, apparently it has had its heyday, or not had it, it may come back again. Mm-hmm. There's been golden eras in... Mm-hmm. Tell us a little bit more about that.
Yeah, so, I mean, we mentioned the very early origins before, but there was a big flowering of harp guitar making around about sort of 1900s, 1910, 1920, 20 or 30 years, perhaps longer. Companies like Gibson even made a massive thing with just tons of strings. I don't know how many strings they made. In America, there's a lot of things getting made in America.
Yeah, so it's not set at 23 strings.
No, they're all very different. This is the thing. It's a loose description. A harp guitar is a fretted instrument with a few extra strings. But how many extra strings is kind of very much, it varies an awful lot.
Okay, right. But so there was this blossoming in late 19th, early 20th century.
Yeah. Yeah, and the reason they were made at that point, apparently, is because they wanted louder guitars. This was before amplification, the days of amplification, of course. So to play in music halls and shows, you wanted a louder guitar because the guitar is quite a quiet instrument. So they built extra strings and bigger bodies, and they gave it more resonance and allowed the sound of the guitar to project more into the theatre. They didn't necessarily play them as articulately as players do today, I gather, but I haven't heard many recordings.
Well, there wouldn't be many recordings of that either, would there?
So we're not really sure about that. But of the few recordings that I've seen, they're very much just strumming chords. But if you just strum chords on this, then the extra strings give a big resonance, so it does make it a louder, more resonant instrument.
Because obviously they're an octave. Yeah. There, you get resonance from it. Yeah. Okay.
And then, of course, some electricity came along, amplification came along, and you didn't need to build such complicated instruments. You just plug it in and turn up the volume. So they kind of died a death after that and stopped being built.
That would make sense because it was 1930s that electric recording came about as well, wasn't it?
So, exactly. So they weren't needed as such for that purpose.
Okay, and what happened to these hundreds of harp guitars?
Yeah, well, they became obsolete for that time period and they got forgotten about and they sort of reappeared. Everyone stopped playing them as far as we can tell. And then they kind of reappeared and people would find them in grandfather's loft when you're going out to clear the house after the passing away of the grandfather. In fact, Stephen Bennett, that's the story about him. I mean, apparently his grandfather passed away, and it was they were clearing out the house, and he went up into the loft and found this strange-looking instrument in a case up in the loft, took it out, and thought, wow. Yeah, here's
what's
something
this,
we could,
then?
Yeah, let's have a go at this. And stick some strings on it. Write your own rule book, because there's no rights and wrongs. Tune it however you feel like doing it, and just get started and have some fun. So there was a flowering later on in sort of 70s and 80s, 80s onwards. I think they kind of got rediscovered, and there was more interest.
Yes, so that would be 50 years after the after they sort of disappeared.
Yeah. And then now they're kind of more of a quirky kind of niche thing, I suppose, or for some people anyway.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, from that description, therefore, I mean, it's clear from watching you play this, you can play the guitar, because you have to be able to do those middle six strings.
Yeah.
So you came to this through the guitar.
Yeah, I mean, I'm a professional guitarist. You know, I play classical guitar, Spanish and flamenco guitar for a living most of the time.
Okay.
When times are good, anyway.
Right, okay, when you can get the bookings.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Okay, and So that leads on to your last track that you've chosen, I think.
Yeah, my last track is by Vicente Amigo, a Spanish flamenco, but kind of progressive flamenco. He's fusing into jazz, the jazz world as well, kind of influencing. He always comes from the flamenco sound, but he's also moving into flamenco and jazz, and also kind of Celtic fusions as well. Just marvelous player, probably regarded as arguably the best player alive now. Now okay. that Paco de Lucía is no longer with us. Perhaps that's a name which some people may or may not know, the famous yes. flamenco guitarist of the 20th century. Yeah. He died a couple of years ago, and now Vicente Amigo is, to my mind, the best player alive, and arguably anyway, certainly up there in the top few. Wonderful player. This is a piece, I play a version of this piece, nothing like Vicente plays it. He's the master, absolutely, but I do a version of this piece. I kind of love this piece to play. It's one of my favourite ones to play at gigs and concerts and things. So.
Okay.
So you're going to ask me to pronounce the title now, aren't you?
Well, I manage the Russian. So,
yeah, right. I'll need to see it written down. I can translate it into English anyway. Well, in Spanish, I think it's something like Tres notas para decir te quiero, which I understand means three notes to say I love you. So it's quite a romantic kind of tune.
So yeah, this
it's a love tune.
Three notes to say I love you by Vicente Amigo.
Vicente Amigo. Mm-hmm.
Vicente Amigo and three notes to say I love you, because I'm not going to attempt the Spanish. Okay, while that's been playing, we've been having a good nose around your harp guitar. Mm. What genre would you describe yourself as?
Oh, that's always the hardest question. I don't want to even try to answer that question. Right. You tell me what genre is. Everyone has a different answer.
Clearly it's got associations with classical guitar.
For me, because I'm a classical guitar player.
Yeah.
It's a bit like saying what genre does a guitar play? Well, it's pretty versatile. You can play any genre, really. Depends.
Absolutely, because guitars are pretty universal. They don't tend to appear in orchestras, but beyond that, they do.
Yeah. And you can play any style on any guitar. Really.
I mean, there's no doubt I've had music not dissimilar to yours on my folk show. So it's certainly some of what you've been playing would fit into that.
Yeah.
And given the titles of some of the tracks you've come up with. That would also seem to resonate because, I mean, we're coming on to the second part of the show now, the third part of the show, where we go back to you having a set where you play live music, your own music that you perform. Mm. And the opening number is Tides at Alderney Point.
Yeah, Tides at Alderney Point. Well, the next three tunes are linked. I think of them as like the Herm Island Suite.
I was going to say they are all geographic titles.
Yeah. Yeah, kind of. Yeah, yeah. In the Channel Islands. I grew up in the Channel Islands. Guernsey was my
right. Okay.
Hello, Guernsey. If anyone's listening from Guernsey, and one of the little islands is called Herm, and we actually lived there, my family, when I was a toddler. So my very earliest memories are on Herm, and it's this kind of.
It's been a very peaceful existence.
Yeah, tiny little sun-kissed island, about a mile and a half long.
I was going to say because I've stood on Sark and seen Herm. Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Well, Sark's a giant compared to Herm. Herm's tiny. And it's basically, there's 40 years ago, when I was a kid living there, there was very little there, just a few tourists and a few very small local businesses. And yeah, I've got these very early hazy memories of life there. And I've been back many times since on holiday, and it's much more touristy today than it was then.
You obviously had a radio, because you heard things like Queen and the...
well, I moved away. I was three or four right, when I moved away from there, so it's... But, I always visited there for day trips and things since.
Yeah.
But, it's one of those places which, you get to some places and they've got like a strength and a kind of power about them, a natural place, a sort of natural force, a natural kind of energy of some sort. I don't know quite how to describe it. Some places you go to, they're just like, some people call them places of power, or John Donne describes them as thin places where the distance between heaven and earth is thin and the distance between past and future is kind of thin. It's kind of a strange kind of concept, but... has a special power to it for me.
Mm.
I'm sure everyone probably knows a couple of places which are special to them. Or yes, maybe it just means something to me as an individual, I don't know.
The way you find your spirit.
Yeah, I suppose So I've been going back there in recent years on holiday and just kind of revisiting some of the old spots. And I've written these three tunes inspired by various points on the island. And this first one is Tides at Alderney Point. Alderney Point is a thin spit of sand which kind of goes out and points towards the island of Alderney. But because it makes a long, thin point, the tides are very kind of... if you stand there, if you sit there over an afternoon and watch the tide going out and coming in again, you see all these kind of eddies and kind of strange currents. And at high tide, you look out, and there's currents going in all sorts of different directions because of the rock formations underneath. And it's it just feels wonderful and wonderfully special. And at low tide, you've got this kind of low, really long, deserted, flat, beautiful beach, like being in the Caribbean or something. So if you sit there, basically this track is kind of trying to depict the process from low tide, where you've got this expanse of sand, gradual coming in of the tide and the kind of the eddying and the flowing of the water, building to the bit where in the middle where it's all kind of very chaotic and very strong and powerful, and then it kind of the tide goes out again, and you're left with this kind of, you know, the seagulls on the rocks again. You know, so it's very, for me, it's just a very special place, and it just, yeah, I try to kind of catch the spirit of the place in some of these tunes.
Okay, that's great.
So shall I play the first tune?
Tides at Alderney Point.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. Okay. So that's the first of almost a trilogy of songs based on her.
Yeah, three-part movement, yeah.
Yeah, okay. Is the second song you've identified, is that the second of the three-part movement?
Yeah, it's St. Jubal's, yeah.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, I was trying to read my own handwriting. It wasn't, wasn't the case of pronouncing it, it was reading my own handwriting.
St. Jubal's Retreat.
Right, okay.
St. Jubal was a monk who spent all his life in his ministry along... He set up monasteries in Wales and the Celtic fringe coast, Cornwall, the Channel Islands, and Normandy, some Milo sort of France sort of way. He went around spending his whole career setting up monasteries and moving on. And Herm, the island of Herm, was for many centuries actually was a monk's retreat. And there's to this day there's a church there about 1,000 years old called St. Jubal's Chapel, and it's built on the site of the original monks' retreat hermitage, if you like. And they built stone walls and farming boundaries and things, and they had a nice little community going there for centuries. It must have been such an idyllic kind of peaceful kind of place for meditation and prayer for the monks, et cetera, with a few villages thrown in for good measure. So in the next piece, I try to kind of capture for me what it seems like must have been such an idyllic, peaceful, tranquil kind of place where the monks just kind of lived their lives and did their meditation and, I guess, try to get closer to God, et cetera. And eventually they moved away. And it became, sold to the crown, et cetera, and had a different history after that, the island. But for that period of 200 to 300 years, it was just like a lovely heavenly island, I suppose. So I guess I've tried to capture something of that in the next tune.
Okay.
I'll need to make sure that I'm in tune before I start playing this one,
okay,
now, I think,
because
we've got a bit of tuning issues. Ask myself why. What am I doing with such an overcomplicated instrument? But I think that's part of the glory of it, part of the fun of it as well. So the audiences just have to kind of bear with me while I tune up a little bit. That's all part of the fun.
There are many guitarists who spend far longer tuning than you do.
Well, yeah, we'll see. Hopefully it'll settle now. Anyway. Okay, so St. Jubal's Retreat. So picture a nice sun-kissed island full of monks.
McDougall's Retreat.
Yeah.
Yeah, really strong atmosphere coming across in these.
Thank you.
If someone wanted to hear more of your music, other than just listening to reruns of this show,
you better book me for a concert, I think. I haven't done many recordings yet. I'm quite new. I've only had this instrument for 2 years. It sounds like a long time, but it's taken me a long time to kind of get tunes written and performable. As you can hear from the mistakes I'm making tonight, I'm nearly there.
Yeah, well, it's all very well being able to play the guitar, but clearly there's quite a lot more to playing one of these.
Yeah, definitely, yeah. It's just very easy to go wrong.
Right, and I'm guessing that you can't just walk into a shop and buy one of these either.
You'd be surprised. No, not shops, not music shops, but there's plenty of makers online, plenty of luthiers online. If you Google around, I could give you loads of names.
Right, okay.
I'm just
how you got into this music. You saw one of these yourself on YouTube.
Yeah, and then I designed this one. Actually, I decided what I wanted. I looked into it a little bit, and most harp guitars these days seem to have these strings, the guitar strings and the bass strings, but not really the treble strings. Fewer around anyway with the super treble strings.
Yeah,
I looked around. I came across the instruments that did have them on. I thought I wanted those as well. So, I decided what string configuration I wanted. And drew out the instrument into a pleasing shape. I think it came out really nicely. And then handed that design over to a maker to make for me, Stuart Mewburn. If you're listening, Stuart, thanks for making this wonderful guitar. A very challenging job for any luthier.
Right, okay. Did he make many changes to your concept?
No. He was wonderful. He faithfully tried to, make real the thing which I designed for him.
Okay, right. So, but he would have understood the sound that it was likely to make.
Yeah, I mean, he makes wonderful flamencos and classical guitars as well. Yeah, so I have another one.
He was going to know how to deliver the sound you wanted as well.
Yeah. But it's a bit of an unknown territory. It's the only one of the only harp guitar he's ever made, the first and probably the last.
Quite a challenge.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, we're going to move on to the final one that you've selected to ask offered to play for us, the Old Spice Road.
Spine Road.
Sorry, yeah, that's my handwriting again.
The Spice Road, that would be a good name for as well.
Yeah, the Old China Spine Wonder. Road,
Herm is a fairly long, thin sort of island with a spinal road over the top, which is built by the monks. And it's just kind of this atmospheric. One day I took a walk down there and it was kind of a foggy day. And there are foghorns around Herm, because obviously you're going to get a lot of shipwrecks if there's not foghorns. So there's one foghorn on one side of the island, which kind of gives its lovely clear tone across the water. Mm. And there's another one across the other side of the island. And if you're walking across the Spine Road, you get to hear them both. So I took a walk down there, and you get this very atmospheric kind of musical note from the foghorns either side, kind of both playing a different pitch. Yeah. And I can hear those two notes in this piece. You won't, because unless you've been to Herm, unless you spend a lot of time listening to those foghorns.
I've been very close to Herm, but not in the fog.
Yeah.
I was there for the Sark Folk Festival in wonderful sunshine, being able to look over to Herm. It was like a soundtrack.
Right, yeah, I've heard good things about Sark Folk Festival.
Yeah, but no, I haven't been there in the fog.
Yeah. Well, it has a special mood. Like I said, the whole island is imbued with this kind of lovely kind of feel to the whole thing. Yeah. And in the fog and the mist, it's just more atmospheric.
Yeah.
And I was just walking down the road. It only takes you 20 minutes to walk down the Spine Road, and then you fall off the island.
Yeah, then you're at the other end.
But somehow the tune kind of started coming to me as I was pacing along the road, and then took it home and spent the next year or so trying to make it real into a real piece of music.
Okay.
So I will need to tune up a little bit more.
Okay, and then I'll we'll let you do that, and then we'll hear the Old Spine Road.
Uh-huh. This is the Old Spine Road.
Mm-hmm.
That was the Old Spine Road, which very nicely rounds off your set for the night.
Yeah. That's kind of all I've got at the moment.
You've played seven songs, I think, for us tonight.
Yeah.
Five of which you've written yourself.
Yeah,
I
that's
think.
Right. Yeah.
What's the plan?
Well, obviously, there's an album on the way, so I've got.
I was rather hoping to be saying that.
Yeah. And I'm halfway through recording that at the moment, so I've got three or four tracks recorded at the moment.
Right, where's that being recorded?
I do all that my own recording at home. Make it that way, you will.
Okay, no, that's fair.
Yeah. I'd love to go to a studio one day, but it makes sense at the moment. It's all in development as well. I'm kind of sometimes you record things just to hear how they sound back, and if you get a good recording, you can keep it. If you're not, then it's just an experiment. So I need to write a few more tracks. Looking at a few other bits of instrumentation, add some percussion, maybe a few strange instruments here and there to complement the album a little bit, and hopefully get that out fairly soon, and then play concerts and radio stations.
Okay, that's great. Thank you. Well, it's been wonderful having you on Froom FM Soundcheck.
Thank you so much for having me. It's been a great experience.
It's been fascinating sitting here watching you as well as listening to you. So thank you. Everybody, that was Jon Pickard on Froom FM Soundcheck, 96.6 FM and online and on Facebook Live. And the next show we have is December the 17th. The Little Wonder Band, is that right? Little Wonder. Just Little Wonder, and we're going to go out with one of their tracks to give you a taster for the next show. Thank you again, Jon, for being here with us. We're going to go out with Little Wonder and The Beginning of the End.
Plane's about to taxi, we just crossed the Black Sea. Phosphorus is choppy, cross it for